Obey the NWO.
Welcome everyone to the Nerd World Order Podcast. This is Abel Loza, and joining me as always is my co-host and co-conspirator CJ.
Hello everyone.
And Andres and Barker aren't here. The NWO is where we're trying to take over the world by spreading the weekly pop culture news from across different genres, which include movies, comics, TV shows, or anything that we consider nerd. We're the Nerd World Order Podcast, your greatest in poopertainment since 2017. Alright guys, welcome to show 100. We've made it to 100
Holy
shows.
Shit.
It's taken us forever, but we finally got there.
Well, this is awkward. I haven't done anything to prepare for the fact that this is 100 shows in. We should have done something.
We should have.
We should have made a cake or like.
I do have here somebody's idea. I think it was Cody's idea that to make a playlist.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna do that. So I'm gonna work on that this week.
That's
so
pretty good.
Yeah.
I remember I'm a fan of My Brother and Me. Do you know what that is? It's a podcast.
Oh no, I remember the next show, The Brother and Me.
They had their that's not. Not even close, but I do remember that also. So they came up on their 420th show, and it just like sprung up on them, and they're like, "Dude, I don't know. We should have. What? How do you celebrate that?
We should have done something."
And it was like a whole thing. It was really funny. That's what I feel like.
Yeah,
I feel dumb that it like.
I wanted to do something special, but I'm like, it's towards the end of the year. We'll probably do something for 150. But no, 100 is awesome. I just want to say thanks for everybody.
It does just feel good.
It does feel good that you've done something for 100 times. You know. Can't say I've gotten any better at it, but at least at least we've done 100 shows. I just want to say thanks to everybody who's ever listened, whether it was one show, two shows, or all 100. We really appreciate it, and here's to continued growth. I didn't get any beer because CJ has to work after this, and I still got to work out. So.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Not any beer.
Yeah.
Wow, we didn't even have beer on our 100th show.
Yeah, it's fine.
Oh, we are losers.
Yeah, I am drinking coffee out of my Star Wars cup, which is very appropriate. So.
It's apropos.
You don't know the power of the dark side, and it's made you're on the other side, so.
Are we losers for drinking coffee and nothing on our 100th show?
Absolutely, that's 100%. Speaking of, good transition, CJ. We do have our poll questions from last week. We have one question of the show, and that is... one question of the show, but on two platforms. First one's on Facebook. I asked, who was right about the movie of the decade? CJ and Barker for Infinity War or Abel for Endgame? 60% said Endgame on Facebook and 40% said Infinity War on Infinity War, 40%. So I win on Facebook. So let's check it out.
That feels weighted. You did that on purpose.
No, I didn't.
You absolutely did that on purpose.
How did I do that on purpose? I only get one vote and I voted once.
No. I am prejudiced against. You should have just said, what's the movie of the decade, Infinity War or Endgame? It's weighted.
How's
people,
that weighted?
People vote against me all the time.
People vote against me all the time. Do you not know?
I feel like I'm the lesser of the two who get, or more, I guess, who gets voted. I get voted against more.
That's doubtful.
Who gets voted against more? CJ or Abel? We'll figure this out. Poll question. We'll figure this out right now. Well, in a week.
On Twitter, I asked the same question. Exact same result. 60% said Abel, 40% said CJ and Barker, so...
Yeah, it's weighted.
How is that weighted?
It's totally weighted.
People prefer Endgame as a movie.
Well, people are wrong. Okay, subjectively, like, I mean, I'm sorry. I don't even think that's, like, subjective. I think it's pretty objective that Infinity War is the superior movie.
No, Endgame is the superior movie.
I don't think so. There's, like, an hour in there where you're, like, bored.
That's not even
true. The second act is, like...
That's not even true. I don't want you to ever see Endgame ever again, then.
I love Endgame.
Yeah, okay. You're just talking shit.
I'm not talking shit. I'm telling you, Endgame gets an A+, but Infinity War gets an A+ with extra credit.
So like a 110?
Yes, yes.
Nah, I was more emotionally involved in Endgame, for sure. I think most people were.
Yeah, okay. Take your emotion out of it. What's the superior movie?
Endgame.
No.
Yes, it is.
You can't look away during Endgame, like, or Infinity War. It's nonstop. Like, I don't know. I don't know. I'm right. I know I'm right. I can't explain exactly all the reasons why. I just know I'm right.
No, you're not right. You're wrong.
Who's right? CJ or Abel?
Again?
We'll see what happens.
Okay. Poll question. All right. The rest of the polls from last week. Let's see. Let me turn this way so the mic can get me better.
People are going to vote for you, I think. Probably.
Okay. There was a little audio snafu, but we got it. See, just giving an
eye. Pay attention to that.
Yeah, I know. So, where was I? Okay, the rest of the poll questions. Are you allowed to make fun of white people? 91% said yes. Awesome. I think people, just to get offended, will click on the hashtag and then just find our poll. And that's the one person voted no, so.
I hope we get an angry tweet. I hope we get several angry tweets. I hope somebody finds that and it's like a thing. I want that to be a thing.
You know what really made me
mad? I'm ready for that fight.
You know, the other day somebody said white supremacy theory, and that set me off, dude. Yeah. I don't want to get into it. You're welcome, 50-50. Should Abel be made fun of for his lack of preparedness? 100% said yes. Can my 90-year-old grandma work Twitter better than Abel? 75% said yes. Is Cleodonna the Greek goddess of beer? 67% said yes. Should Whitney help Barker out by taking 50 kicks in the balls? 67% said yes.
I think that's a contractual obligation.
It is. That's illegally binding.
Yeah.
Is it fun when your head explodes? 100% said yes. Hashtag poor discovery. Hashtag black holes. Are trailers good at blowjobs? 67% said no. Is that old Sonic like blue paint, a hedgehog, and a human walked into the flight transporter? 67% said yes. 33% said, what the fuck are you talking about? Are they going full butt pounding? 100% said yes. Did you know it's coming? 75% said yes. Do you usually pay more for that? 75% said yes. Did he, quote, let it go? 50-50. Should that guy be kicked out of every frozen section of every store? 75% said yes. Did he replace the carrot with his dick? 75% said yes. Is it insane that no one died on Mad Max? 80% said yes. Should at least 8 people have died during the filming of Mad Max? 80% said yes. So as always, if you guys want to vote on our poll questions, find us on Twitter at NerdWorldOrder1 or on Facebook at NerdWorldOrder1 as well. We usually don't have as many polls on Facebook, but we do have the big question of the show. So transitioning off from that, Whitney is a friend of the show. He always listens to the show and gives us his 2 cents on the previous show, which was last week, and then we read his comments on this weekend. We mostly ignore him, but it's good content, so here we go. Hashtag Whitney says. Okay, there we go. My Wonder Woman theory. Hades becomes involved, hence her dead boyfriend is back. We talked about the trailer last week.
That's a cool theory, and I like it, and I kind of hope that happens.
It's cool when some people don't like it. I like it when they involve the Greek gods.
Me too. I love it, honestly.
First Wonder Woman was good, but overhyped. You're overhyped. I always thought that Ghostbusters 2 was better. I thought so too, but
it's good. I would never say it's better, but it is good. I think it gets a bad rap for an undeserved bad rap.
I think so too. They could have been doing crossplay between systems. The makes have chosen not to. This is one reason PC Master Race is best.
There's a lot of reasons why it's not the best. I don't want to get into them all right now, but I saw that and I was like, dude, okay, calm down.
8K isn't on the market right now. It is in the works, but the refresh rate on a TV is trash. Why they are so much cheaper than monitors. Don't speak too soon on the Great Depression. You fucking jinxed it.
He's probably right about that.
Scott Pilgrim isn't a fun movie, but the protagonist is a pedophile. He probably has 15,000 followers on TikTok.
Does the pedophile protagonist in Scott Pilgrim have 15,000 followers on TikTok? That's a great question.
I was just talking about 50-50 the other day. So fucking good.
What is that? What 50-50?
The movie with Seth Rogen and Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Joseph Gordon-Levitt finds out he has cancer, and he's like super young. It's really good. John Wick is not a trilogy. That is like saying Harry Potter is a trilogy or Friday the 13th is a trilogy. How many movies are there for John Wick? Oh, so that's a trilogy. Okay, thank you.
How many? Yeah, what are you doing there?
Something could happen to Keanu Reeves tomorrow, and that's the end of it. That's a trilogy.
Yep.
So as always, we appreciate the
tips. Yeah, whether or not it will be a trilogy in the future is irrelevant right now.
Yeah.
It's a trilogy.
It's a trilogy. There's 3 movies. Yeah. So as always, thank you, Shitney, for your 2 cents, and we appreciate it, but we are moving on. We always like to pay homage to our old co-host Andres, who said he's going to be back next week, so we'll see. He likes the Star Wars movie, so a little scene, peek behind the curtains, we're going to do that movie next week. But Yeah, no, he said he's going to be back next week. But in the event that he isn't, we do like to pay homage to him and remember him as one of the original co-hosts. But if you guys don't know, he's a big anime fan, the biggest in the world. And he always sends me an email like, hey, well, you have to talk about this on the show. And you have to let the world know that, you know, I love anime so much. And I'm like, okay, man, I got you. Slow down. I got you. All right. So in every week, I read the hottest piece of anime news. And on this week's... The Andres Loza Memorial Anime Minute. Boruto Naruto's Next Generation is quickly coming to an end of its epic time travel arc, which has brought Boruto and Sasuke back to the Hidden Leaf Village of the past to defeat a powerful villain, Urashiki Otsutsuki, who tried to steal Nine Tails from a young Naruto during the interim between the original Naruto series and Naruto Shippuden. Now, Urashiki has been defeated, and as the next episode previews have already shown at the time of writing this, Boruto and Sasuke are looking to make the trip back home to their hometown. However, Boruto maybe shouldn't be so quick to abandon this time travel thread, as it's easily the best thing the anime has going for it. So there you go.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
I can't wait.
You shouldn't.
That's, wow, I'm going to have to go legally download that immediately.
No, you buy it.
Why? Oh, I'm a big supporter of anime is why.
There you go.
And of course,
yeah.
I would buy that. I would not, of course, I'm sorry.
Alrighty. This weekend. Alright, did you hear about the Keanu Day of Reckoning?
Yes, I did. It's weird.
That is weird. So if you guys haven't...
Oh, is Keanu Reeves in Matrix 4?
Yes. He's the star in it. Yeah.
I thought it was like he was like ancillary. Like.
No, he's the main guy in it.
That makes it so much worse.
Yeah. So in case you guys didn't hear, both John Wick 4 and The Matrix 4 are scheduled to come out on the same day in 2021, which is May 21st of 2021. So to prove that Keanu has staying power, this Keanu...
He does. Never went away.
This Keanu sounds is running up until 2021. And yeah, John Wick and The Matrix are coming out on the same day. So CJ, I got to ask you a very important question since you are a big Keanu Reeves fan. If you can only pick one of the two movies to watch, and you can only watch one, which one are you picking?
John Wick.
Really?
Yeah.
Because
the Matrix trilogy is perfect, and they're fucking up. I don't want it. I don't want Matrix 4. I don't want it. I'm scared of it. It's gonna ruin it.
So you're more excited than for the John Wick movies?
Oh, absolutely.
You're scared.
I'll watch John Wick movies till the end of time. it's a perfect formula. How you can't mess that up? That's impossible to mess up, right? You can't. The only way is if they would tone it down, and they're not gonna. Come on.
No, they're definitely not gonna.
Just keep cranking it up. 12, 13, 14, let's go. And, like, it's you can't lose. Matrix? Matrixes have to be well-written. They have to be impeccably acted, beautifully directed, incredibly edited. There's a lot going on in a Matrix movie that can go wrong. Mainly, it's like 90% writing, right? And I'm scared of it. Not much writing has to go into a John Wick movie.
That's true.
Even though
I mean,
it can. It's
a lot
it's
of action
awesome.
And shit.
But I'm way more hyped for John Wick 4. But it's not close. Yeah.
You know,
even though I will see both.
You're not excited for it?
With the Matrix?
Yeah.
No.
Like at all?
No, I don't want it. I'm upset that they're doing it. That's annoying.
Hmm. I'm excited
Are you not?
For it. I'm excited for it because I don't hold those movies in such high regard as you do. So I'm pretty excited for it. Just to see if they can make it better.
Do you think? Okay. That's what I was gonna ask you.
Yeah.
Do you think it'll like? Not that I don't think, because you don't not like it, right?
I don't like it, but I thought that could have been better.
Right,
yeah,
but
yeah.
You think it could be a little bit redeeming in that regard? Like, it might the addition of this movie, if it's good, will
in hindsight make the trilogy
right.
better? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, I see.
Yeah,
I think it'll make it worse. I'm you're excited that it could make it better. I'm totally fearful that it'll make it worse.
We'll
so,
see,
we'll
but
see what
but I, I'm on the same boat as you that I think. I'm most excited for John Wick as well, so yeah, for sure. If I only had to pick one, that's a poll question.
Yeah,
if you can only pick one, which one are you watching, John Wick or...
I feel like you could put John Wick movies for me against most movies, and John Wick will win. Like, that could be a lot of things. I'd pick that over Star Wars.
What if, yeah, what if they're picking, jeez, I gotta fix this. What if it was between that and they released, like, a Secret Avengers movie?
Oh, man, a Secret Avengers movie?
Yeah.
I'd have to go Avengers.
Oh, yeah, for sure?
Yeah, are we not being picked up?
Yeah, we are. It's just, I'm afraid it's too loud, so let me turn it down.
You said we sounded great, then you messed with it. Classic Abel.
There we go. Okay, that should be good. Okay.
This is Classic Abel.
Poll question.
No one knows what we're talking about.
It's because, you see up there, I'm afraid when it's in the yellow part, because that's when it sounds like...
Oh, I see.
You know what I mean? Okay, I think we should...
How about now? Yeah, I edit all this crap out. I'm sorry.
Probably not. Whatever makes it easier for me.
No one knows what we're doing. It doesn't matter. No one ever knows what we're doing.
No.
Do you guys ever know what we're doing? Pull question.
No. Let's try that.
Okay.
Okay.
But yeah, so just drive the point home. Okay. MCU over... That's not fair, though. MCU over everything. But John Wick over everything else.
Except the MCU.
Right.
Okay. Moving on.
Probably Predator.
We are on that time crunch, so let's see. Shazam. There was a bunch of release date news. Shazam 2 is getting released officially April 1st of 2022. This will be just a few months after Black Adam's released. Black Adam is scheduled to be released December 22nd of 2021. So honestly, like, the Shazamiverse is getting like a mini trilogy, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, so not too bad. What do you think?
I like it. I'm here for it. Shazam's a good movie.
Yeah, I like Shazam a lot. I
anticipate them all being good movies.
Good. All right. The Flash, maybe. The Flash has been pushed back so many times that they say that this one's officially going to be released on July 1st, 2022. But what?
You're like super high. If that's a thing you're worried about, you're super high in the red.
Oh, yeah?
Every time you just speak, can't see.
Hello. Is that better, you think?
I can't hear it.
There
some,
we go.
Some jackass broke my headphones.
I'll buy you a new pair. I
haven't been able to hear for 3 months.
Okay. No, there we go. Okay. Or maybe I should just step back a little bit. There you go. That works. Yeah.
Your voice always sounds really good. You always, more than either of us, you always sound really good. So. My you should voice. Have a voice for radio.
No. I don't have a voice for radio at all.
I don't know. Does anyone have a voice for radio? Of course.
Okay. I'll fix it. I gotta step back a little bit. There we go. I think I'm too close to the mic. Okay. But yeah, there's been a long history of the Flash movies being pushed back. This is the fourth time now, so we'll see if it goes. But yeah, it's supposed to be released July 1st, 2022, with Ezra Miller still as the Flash. So we'll see. I feel like
wasn't he doing the movie? Like it's his baby.
That was one of the iterations before, two directors ago. But now it's Andy Muschietti who directed the two It movies. So we'll see how it goes. Okay. And last bit of movie news that we're gonna get Mortal Kombat earlier than we expected. The original release date was March 5th of 2021. But now we're gonna get it January 15th, 2021.
For a new what?
They're moving up Mortal Kombat.
Oh, more okay, yeah. Sorry. I thought you said I don't know why I thought you said a new It movie.
No. Mortal Kombat. Mortal Kombat. Yeah. So.
I don't know. Sorry.
Would you be excited for a Mortal Kombat movie?
I mean, I could watch it. I'd be more excited for a cool game, which apparently the new game that came out is supposed to be amazing.
That's what I heard too. Yeah.
So I think of more Mortal Kombat like hit its heyday when I was a kid. That's just what I think. I don't know if that's true or not. That's just
I have that shit on Super Nintendo. Mortal Kombat 3.
Yeah. That's just for me personally. I know a lot of people are still into it, but I don't know. I don't think I could get really that into one of those.
Is that your favorite fighting game?
Yeah, that's my favorite fighting game. I'm just not really that into fighting games.
Yeah. Some people live for that shit.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And they're cool. They're fun. Like, when I get into one, it's fun. I never get that into one. Like, grading on the games curve as far as other games.
For sure. Hey, CJ.
Yeah?
Do you love the NWO?
Yeah.
Do you like supporting things you love by giving them an amount of money so small that you wouldn't notice or feel leaving your bank account?
Yeah.
Then you'd be perfect to donate to the NWO cause, which will help us create more content and become a better podcast. Is that something you like to do?
Yeah.
Then visit us on patreon.com/noworldorder and give us a monthly donation to help us out. Or, if you want, give us a one-time donation. Please go to our PayPal at noworldorder2@gmail.com.
Yeah?
Yeah. And remember, folks, obey the NWO.
Yeah.
Alrighty, CJ didn't bring any news, did you?
No. Okay, that's fine. I think that benefits us.
Yeah, so. That's fine. Barker, obviously. Did I mention it was going to be Barkerless?
They probably figured. Yeah. Have you guys figured out by now that Barker's not here? Of course.
What did he say he had? He had butt bugs or butt plugs?
Oh, yeah, he's out with the butt bugs.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Just in and out, worms.
I gave them to him. Yeah. So, sorry.
What are you going
to
do?
Yeah, give them to him and come do the show.
This week's main topic is we are going to revisit the Star Wars trilogies.
I think this will be a longer conversation.
Yeah, too. So... and the reason Barker isn't here is he's working and he hasn't seen the movies. So
he's seen like 3, I think. Yeah. And I crammed them all. So.
Yeah. That's what I'm caught up. That's what I'm excited for. But before we get into that, we do have some Florida Man news. With that being said, Florida Man died from meth overdose before he was eaten by alligators. A methamphetamine intoxication killed Michael Fort before the reptile tore his body apart.
I think, isn't that just how you die in Florida?
I was about to say, that's their Viking funeral, you know?
Yeah. That's just
inject your body full of meth and they eat you. Yeah, for sure. Honestly, when I read that, I was like, that is the most Florida headline I've ever read, and it's never going to get any better than that. I should just stop the segment after that, because it's not going to get any better. Alrighty, so, like I said, Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, comes out next week, which we'll definitely review. But I kind of wanted to recap the universe, the movie universe, because there's a bunch of stuff.
And which I think would be super interesting to get into. Just time crunch.
Yeah, yeah.
But I really do want to look. This says maybe you want to watch shows.
Yeah, which we could possibly do, because I want to watch the Clone Wars again. I have Disney Plus, it's on there. And they're going to release a new season of it. So maybe we can do that for the release of that. But yeah, so the big tagline for this, it's the end of the Skywalker saga. I said 2 weeks ago or last week that I like Star Wars, but my big beef with it is they live in this huge galaxy, this huge universe. But everything always revolves around one family, like 8 people.
You know, I'd like to defend that a little bit. I agree with you. That's true. It's a pretty freaking important family.
The Force.
I mean, there's a reason. I was thinking about that. There's a reason the stories are drawn to those characters. It's because the Force.
Understand.
That's really what it is.
So, that's...
I mean, really what it is they love those characters, don't want to let them go. But
yeah,
the movie reason is that it's the Force.
Yeah. Yeah, and like I said, this would be extra fun because CJ did cram all the movies over the week, and I let him borrow actually The Last Jedi. We were supposed to record yesterday, but I really wanted him to watch that because that's the most controversial Star Wars movie.
Which I gotta admit, I don't understand why
it's so controversial. We'll get into it. But yeah, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna kind of not movie per movie because we are kind of in a little bit of a crunch and I gotta get CJ out of here to go to work. But we'll hit some highlights on all the movies and stuff and then ask some questions as far as like your favorite character, favorite movie, stuff like that. Rank them because it's the internet and we have to rank them, I guess. So. Yeah. Alrighty, CJ, we'll start here. We're going to break them down chronologically through the story. So it starts, episode 1 came first chronologically, but its release date was 1999.
Oh, Feminist?
Yeah.
Yeah, somewhere in there.
1999. So well, how does the story of the Skywalker saga Star Wars start off with?
So there's a couple guys. They have, it's a trade war. There's a big blockade, and they go try to fight their way out, but they weren't supposed to, but they found out they're being, it's an ambush from some unnamed crazy Darth guy, and what else happens? It's been a long time since I've seen that movie. Oh, they find Jar Jar Binks, because they went to Naboo to talk to Princess Amidala. Padme, I think your name's Padme. He's totally Padme. This is the worst. It's been a long time. The main takeaway, really what you need to know, Darth Maul dies, which he shouldn't have.
I've always said this from day one, because this is my Star Wars, like, I saved money.
It's a good show.
I saved
good movie.
I saved money to go watch this movie. Like, I was 99, I was 10 years old. You know, this is my Star Wars. But I will, for on my tombstone, it'll say Darth Maul, the most underappreciated and underused movie character of all time.
I think they know that now.
He should have been the villain for all three of them, up until you get Darth Vader. I think they should have used them more often, which I think is why they're trying to shoehorn him into other things.
Yeah, that's exactly why.
They put him in Solo, remember that? Mm-hmm. And then they put him in, if you ever get to watch it, the Clone Wars. He's in the Clone Wars, and he's in Rebels, because he's popular. Look behind you. I love Darth Maul. I got a little action figure of him.
Oh, he absolutely died in the movie, and they realized their mistake and brought him back.
Yeah.
He absolutely was
meant to. He would have made the... There's beef with the trilogy, I know, whatever, but he ultimately, I think, would have made the trilogy that much better if you already think it's good.
I think it's good.
Or if you, I guess you answered one of my questions, but, or if you thought they were middling to bad, I think Darth Maul could have solved a lot of those problems if you maintain one specific villain throughout, one thread of a villain throughout the prequel trilogy. So.
I think I agree completely. Yeah.
So, it's funny, though, that you mentioned that it starts off with the trade war deficit or thing or whatever.
Federation block.
Yeah, a lot of people have beef with that. Like, you know, it's like this is supposed to be about Jedis and Sith and stuff like that. And then the prequels are basically about, like, war. Politics and trade wars and stuff like that. Does that at all bug you or anything?
No, I like that kind of thing. This is probably weird, but I enjoy the politics of Star Wars. I like the political theory stuff going on. In my head, it was actually really fun for me to watch, because with the exception of The Phantom Menace, I watched the entire first trilogy, Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith, but I knew, like I said, I'd seen Phantom Menace before, but it was really fun to go into my head and kind of separate out, okay, here it's the Republic versus the Separatists. But it morphs into the Republic. One side, it goes from being the Republic to being the Republic and eventually it turns into the Empire. And it does kind of like a, not a 180, but like a 90.
Yeah.
And it becomes a completely different, they're two completely different sides than they were when they started out.
A very different dynamic, yeah. Yes.
And it's fun to kind of like see how that happens. Like, because the Republic in the beginning was good, it represented the good guys. The Jedi was Team Republic, but little did they know the Republic was essentially being taken over by the Sith.
And that's what I like about it, that when you see how Emperor Palpatine was kind of working behind the scenes and how he was able to manipulate the Republic to turn into the Empire. Mm-hmm. By politicking, I like that.
Absolutely, really enjoy it.
Yeah, and a lot of people are just like sword fight, but I appreciated the fact that you see behind the scenes of how he was able to kind of transform it from a democracy to a dictatorship, really.
Yeah.
by becoming the Empire.
The Emperor. Yeah, I like movies that don't follow the kind of just beats that you're supposed to follow. There's no. This is the good side. This is the bad side. It morphs throughout the series. And I thoroughly enjoy that a lot.
What'd you think of Qui-Gon, Liam Neeson? Or Liam Neeson as Qui-Gon?
He was very good.
I like it too.
I like the character of Qui-Gon.
I do too.
I mean, I get they had to kill somebody, right? But it would have been cool to see him. I kind of felt like he was taken away from us too early. But they got to do someone. I get it. Like... And, he was a good character, and I wish we would have got more of him.
And I think you couldn't have casted anybody better than Ewan McGregor as Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Yeah.
Like, he's perfect in that. Which I think a lot of people, whether you like it or hate it, a lot of people do like Ewan McGregor as Obi-Wan Kenobi. Which is why he's coming back for the Disney Plus show. They're making a show.
How can you even say any... I don't even have a problem with any of the performances, to be honest with you.
I do, and we'll talk about it when we get to Attack of the Clones, but that's by far my least favorite Star Wars movie.
Attack of the Clones?
Yeah.
Why?
I guess we can, but before we move into that, probably one of my, not only just favorite Star Wars scenes, but one of my favorite scenes and movies altogether is the lightsaber,
the
duel of the fates. Yeah. Ho ho, ho ho, ho ho, ho ho. And then they're fighting, dude.
I guess I haven't thought of the soundtrack.
This duel of the fates when they're fighting, favorite Star.
You're talking about Phantom Menace, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Watch.
That's cool.
Okay, we'll just keep feeling there. But yeah, that is my favorite. Even
probably
more,
me too.
Even more than like the reveal that he's Luke's father, or the blowing up of the Death Star in Episode 4. Like, that is one of my favorite scene probably. And that song,
I probably agree with you, where
they fight, is my favorite more than the original soundtrack. You know, or the Darth Vader Death March. Like, it's my favorite. Watch.
I think I gotta go with the main theme there. It's iconic.
Let it kick in. I dare YouTube. That's
cool,
dude.
Okay, yeah, I know what you're talking
about. Okay, yeah, it's fucking dope, and I love that. But Episode 1 gets a bad rep. I think it's a lot of people's least favorite Star Wars movie. We'd be stupid not to bring up the one thing that I think people hate the most in Episode 1, and that's Jar Jar Binks. Yeah. What do you think of him as a character? In hindsight now, I get it. But as a kid, I was like, oh, that's Jar Jar Binks. But he's like... And a lot of the characters have racist undertones. Have you noticed that in that movie? The Trade Federation guys, the little, like, no-nose kind of aliens. Super kind of Asian stereotype a little bit.
Oh, yeah, I didn't know that.
And then Jar Jar Binks, the Misa. And I was like, that's... huh. Yeah, so...
Okay, no, I didn't pick up on that.
Yeah.
that's crazy.
Especially when I rewatched it a few years ago, I'm like, yeah, that's kind of...
But okay. At the risk of alienating a bunch of people, I don't know. But I think people look for that stuff where it isn't sometimes. I'm not saying that's what happened.
Yeah.
That could be. But I think, like, there's a market of people who look for that, and it might not necessarily be there. Somebody said, this is a whole different, I'm going to tangent.
That's fine.
It's a whole different thing. Somebody said Predator is...
because of the dreadlocks and stuff like that, yeah.
And it's in L.A.
Yeah. The second one I can see a little bit, but not the first one.
Yeah,
the first one, he's just an alien.
Yeah, and just to me, that kind of tells me, like, people, they're just looking for that.
Yeah.
And I guarantee, well, I shouldn't guarantee, but I can say with a fair amount of confidence that the creators weren't thinking about that. Oh, yeah, of course, that makes it, no. Let's represent these people this way.
Those people that say that would not be bitching at all if they saw the original costume for the Predator, like a lobster monster. Have you seen it?
Yeah,
with Jean-Claude Van Damme. Yeah. They'd be not be bitching. I think the Predator, no matter what you think of the latter movies or the one that just came out, whatever, he is undoubtedly one of the best character designs for sure of all time. Yeah, and he's
probably number one.
Yeah,
I've heard a lot of people make that argument that the Predator is the best creature character. Regardless of what you think of the movies.
Yeah.
Just character design.
Oh, for sure. If not your favorite, at least top three. Like, at least.
Yes.
Whether or not, like, you like it. Because I think some people will have that bias. Like, I don't like the movies. Well, fuck you. And second, he's a good character design. Yeah. So, yeah, for sure.
I'm sorry for always dragging every conversation we have into Predator.
It's fine. We did a whole month for Predator. Just for you, CJ. It's fine. Yes. Okay. So, ultimately, in the lore of Star Wars, where does one fit for you?
Pretty high up for me. Because I love that scene just like you do, and it carries a lot of weight. I was pretty sad when Qui-Gon... I remember watching that as a kid. I watched it. I didn't go to the theater, but I watched it on TV. Mm-hmm. And I remember the promotions, the Pepsi cans.
I drank so many Pepsis trying to collect all the cans. I never got to it, right? But I had like 1,000 Sabobas, the alien racer in the podcast, the pod racing scene.
There are toys everywhere. Pizza Hut did a whole thing. Yeah. I remember all of it. And I was really hyped for that movie, to be honest. I watched it. I loved it. I still, to this day, I'm not as passionate as you are, but I'm in that boat. I'm in the same boat as you.
Dude, I'm probably seeing this movie with, you know, bias color, you know, rose, whatever you want. However to say. Glasses. Yeah. But yeah, dude, I was so into it. My first Star Wars, we went that premiere weekend. I saved cans to save money to... you know, to go to the movies and stuff. And I thoroughly enjoyed it, you know. I could see maybe as an adult watching it and it's not the original trilogy. But then it's like, if you separate that into its own thing, I thoroughly enjoyed Phantom Menace, so.
One thing I do remember being annoyed by Jar Jar Binks.
Yeah.
Like, honestly. Then. I remember he annoyed me. I mean, it's been more perspective and I think, there's a reason. But even then, he was like, his voice just annoyed me. He was just generally annoying. And I guess a bunch of internet nerds took and ran with that. I just thought, yeah, that kind of sucks.
You know, like,
but they were like, this ruins the movie. I'm like, okay.
You know, that guy went through like a huge depression and stuff, and like, it almost ruined his life.
What, the guy who plays
Jar Jar Binks? Yeah, like, it really fucked with him. Yeah, it was bad, dude. Like, depression, like, suicidal. Yeah.
My goodness, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's why.
Did you know internet nerds almost murdered Jar Jar Binks?
Bull question, dude. That's why, like, out of all the fandoms, Star Wars, it could be great because you always hear stories of like, some guy was dying of cancer, like terminal cancer, and they showed him the movie early, and like, that's
like, saved his life.
I don't know about saved his life, but he got an early screening, right? Because he's dying. Yeah. But like, the worst part of Star Wars fandom is so fucking toxic, dude. And we'll get to it when we talk about Episode 8.
I mentioned that.
The Last Jedi.
I really want to know. But okay, well, let's keep
going. Don't forget. Okay, well, I'll bring it up now because I might forget. So in Episode 8, what was her name? Rose in the movie, right? She.
Yeah,
she's of Asian American descent, and a lot of racist trolls online like just fucking berated her with shit to the point where she like had to delete all social media, like stayed away from the public eye because like that's not my Star Wars and shit like
just
that.
Just because she's Asian?
Some of it had to play with that. The other part is like they didn't like her character very much. But okay, so if you don't like her character, that's fine. I wasn't a big fan of the character either, but I'm not online either. Like, you should die, you know, yeah. Asian slur name. Like, that's fucking bullshit.
And so, what, their beef is, or their solution is?
It's her fault. It's not the writer's fault. It's not whatever. It's her fault. Like, dude, like, legitimately, like, really toxic environment.
That has to be a vocal minority thing.
It is, like, it is. But sometimes the minority, like, or I should say sometimes.
I would think I'm very small.
I shouldn't say sometimes. I say most of the time the minority is the vocal, you know, so. Yeah.
I can't think that that's a very big representation. No.
Yeah. But I guess what I'm getting at is people love this so much that it can get pretty toxic. Thing. Yeah, sometimes. So, but not you guys listening. You guys are awesome. Right. Okay, so now we're moving into Episode 2, Attack of the Clones. This one was released 2003, I believe. This one I didn't see opening weekend, but I did see it in the movie theaters. It's fine. It's not my favorite Star Wars movie. Honestly, if we get to rank them, my least favorite one. Because I think you said you really had no beef with the performances. I think Christian Hayden in this movie not phones it in, but kind of like is not great at it. And
Anakin?
Yeah. And the way George Lucas wrote the love story between Padme and Anakin, it's like he has never been in love before or has never like had human emotions before, and it's so robotic and stuff. And just this movie has the worst dialogue of all of them. And that's why it's not. It's a cool idea of like the premise of like this is where the first clones and then stormtroopers, like this is where they originate. It started off by a Jedi that kind of went rogue and he believed that we needed, like, all that is cool. But to me, the romance where they're trying to do, where they're trying to get us to show how they fell in love and stuff, it just doesn't seem like George Lucas ever has been in love before. And yeah, I don't know. And I guess it didn't seem forced to you.
No, it seems like that's what would happen in that situation to me. Okay, you know what? The Jedi here need to take some blame. You put the two people who aren't supposed to fall in love, who you already know have romantic inclinations toward each other.
They put them together.
You put them together on their own planet. What did you expect to happen? You got to take a little bit of blame here, Jedi Council. That's bad. What are you doing? What are you doing? Come on, man. But I think any two people who are, what would you say? They're not legally allowed to be in love. That's how it happens, I think.
I think it's clunky.
I think it's probably a little awkward between them. I think, but they're just drawn towards each other while trying to resist it. That's how it happens, I think.
Yeah.
I think it makes sense.
Forbidden fruit.
Yeah, that's what it is. It's not gonna be a normal romance, I guess. It's gonna. That seems logical to me, actually.
Does the age difference in Phantom Menace ever come cross your mind when you're watching it in Attack of the Clones?
It's not that different. It's like
9 to 15 or something like that.
Yeah. Those age differences just get a lot shorter as you age.
Yeah, that's true. But it's kind of abrasive to see like
9 and 15?
Something like that. Like 9 and 14, something like that.
Divided by 2 plus 7, what is that? I'm still not even close. But they weren't even, like, romantically linked at that point. Like, it's not... That's innocent enough, you know? No, it never bothered me.
Another thing that people like to make fun of this movie for is the diner scene, because it's like they're in outer space, but there's a diner. Do you remember that scene? No. Okay. Well, we won't talk about it then. But yeah, ultimately, it ranks towards the bottom of the Star Wars movies for me, so...
It does not for me, because I love the... I guess I don't know if it's the B story, but the other story, the mystery that Obi-Wan's solving.
That's the best part of that movie. It's really interesting
to me. Yeah.
I do like the Easter egg at the end when... I don't think it's General Grievous, but the one that flies or whatever, when he pokes the little thing in it, they see the plans for the Death Star, like the very original plans for the Death Star towards the end. That's cool. So when you put stuff like that, that's really cool. And then here is the beginning of the Clone Wars, and that is when the cartoon pops in, and the cartoon makes that movie so much better, I think, because it fills in, because you're led to believe that in the original trilogy that... Anakin Skywalker was this great general during the Clone Wars, and you really don't get to see that in the movie. The cartoon fills that in, and you're like, oh, yeah, he's great. So if they could ever go back and, like, you know, they're making these, like, apart movies, like, they're making Solo and Rogue One and stuff like that. Make an Anakin movie where he is in a war movie. Dude.
And he's just generaling.
Yeah, dude, that would be so badass. I would so dig that movie. It'd be really cool. And you can kind of start seeing, because... We'll talk about next. My favorite prequel is Revenge of the Sith, but his turn to the dark side is kind of sudden a little bit.
I was calling it. I liked calling that movie the precipitous decline. I don't know why. It's cool.
Yeah.
But it is. It's quick.
Yeah, and so a movie that where he's generaling around and you can kind of see, you know,
bits and pieces.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I like it better that it's sudden. I really do. Because it's like, he's supposed to be the prophecy child, right? They're building him up that way. And I like the idea that it can just be one thing, and it happens real quick. Because it's all this power, and there's all this power regardless of wherever it is, and it just gets suddenly pointed in the wrong direction. And I like that.
I guess you do kind
of... You're going to have the same amount of power.
I guess you do kind of see it a little bit when he kills all the sand people and he's like, you know... And,
yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
That whole movie is dedicated. It's that... The Revenge of the Sith is written to... This is how it happens.
Remember when Jose had his little Padawan, right? That was funny.
I do remember that. Is he a Star Wars fan?
I don't think so. I just think he saw it in a magazine or something. I think it was trendy at the time. All right. So now we're going to move into episode 3, and I kind of spoiled it a little bit, but it is my favorite of the prequels, and that's saying a lot because I love episode 1 just because of Darth Maul and everything. But I think that lightsaber fight between Obi-Wan Kenobi and Anakin at the end is fantastic. I really like that. I like how almost the entire third act of that movie is that lightsaber fight.
I enjoy it. Yeah, I like the mechanics of how it happens, how the manipulation, kind of the backdoor politics. I love all that stuff.
That's what I'm saying. I really enjoyed that. And a lot of people are like, man, give me, you know, whatever. But I'm like, that's not...
There's plenty of that.
Yeah.
Like action scenes. Like these movies are good for action. But you don't... I think it's lessened unless you get some of that backstory stuff. Like, I thought they had a pretty good balance, to be honest. But...
And a lot of people, what they criticize the prequels for is they don't really have a thread, like a main character. But I would argue it's obviously Anakin. Yeah. And not only that, but also the decline of the Republic. Like, that's also the center.
Yeah. If you're interested in that stuff, these movies are greatly interesting.
Yeah, for sure.
Which I am.
Yeah, so. I like that. Because at the end of Attack of the Clones, we see how Emperor Palpatine starts getting some more of that power, and there's an emergency, like...
And that's what I was talking about. That's how it starts to shift in between, like, 1 second Jedi or pro-Republic. Suddenly, there's no longer a Republic, and they find themselves, if you follow that path, on the same side of the Sith. Well, that don't make any fucking sense.
Yeah.
So now we're Separatists, but they're not really Separatists either. So now there's, like, 4 different teams,
yeah,
and it's all jumbled together. It's cool. I like that.
I like that, too. What else do I like from episode 3? Let's see.
Well, obviously the end is awesome.
Well, that's what we're... Yeah, that's what... Yeah. The transformation. Yeah.
The literal transformation.
But I will say the one thing that bugged me, even when I watched it, was when when he asked the Emperor what happened to Palpatine, and she said Palpatine told her that he died, and Darth Vader lets out the no. Even yeah, then, I was like, that's a little cheesy. Yeah, but cheesy. I think.
Well, what would you do? I don't know.
Better writing is you see a grunt and you like force choke him to death. Like that's just me.
Yeah, that's not bad.
What I mean? Yeah. And you could see like his living rage because he's so mad.
I like that. That was cool.
Yeah.
Like that's just like how powerful the force is in him. Like I don't know. I thought that was cool.
Yeah.
It was a nice touch.
I do like the idea of the Order 66. Execute Order 66.
That was a trip. That made me really sad.
Yeah.
Because I love, who doesn't love a good Jedi?
Yeah, for sure. And for sure. Yeah. And I do like the.
That was the height of Jedi-ness. Mm-hmm. And it's never been. They've never been back since.
I do like the idea that they've spun a lot of story ideas out of this, that there were not all of them were executed and some of them were spread out throughout the galaxy and stuff. And I like the idea that you follow some of those, like Ahsoka and the main character in Rebels. Like he's one of these forgotten Jedi. And then it's not canon anymore, but the Force Awakens, not Force Awakens, the Force Unleashed, the video game. That was part of that they were forgotten, like, Jedis and stuff like that.
Wow, cool.
A lot of that isn't canon anymore, but...
But you gotta... That's probably the most historic... That changed the most of any order throughout the Star Wars history, you gotta think, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
Yeah, and that's why...
That's a huge turning point.
That's why a lot...
In the history of Star Wars.
A lot of the uncanons, or a lot of the canon stuff that they go back and try to write for, like the missing piece of that story, always seems to be between Episode 3 and Episode 4, because there's so much you can tell there from the turn of the clones to Stormtroopers and stuff like that, because there's just so much shifting in the world of Star Wars that it's very interesting and stuff, which I guess we can kind of talk about them briefly here. Rogue One and Solo, this is where they take place. In Rogue One's obviously the story of how they get the plans of the Death Star, and then Solo is the movie of the origin story of Han Solo and stuff. We've talked about at least Solo on this podcast, so you can go back and listen to that, but Rogue One, we really haven't talked about that here, but if it's not my favorite Star Wars movie, it's up there. I really, really enjoy Rogue One.
It probably is my favorite Star Wars
movie. Yeah. Even if you would have just shown me the last 30 seconds of that fucking movie. I fucking love that movie.
That movie's great all the way through, but all you need is that last 30 seconds. And there should be a whole... There should be way... I hope... It would be cool to see an entire series of that. Like, I don't know about a cartoon series.
Well, there's been comic books, Vader Down, where it's the only thing about that is, like, you see Darth Vader, like, kicking ass.
That's what I want. I want an entire movie of just Darth Vader doing Darth Vader things. Because the mythos, right, is already there by the time we get to 4. And we don't... I wish... It's kind of like you said with Anakin. The idea is that he's this great general. You don't really see why. And the idea is already... Darth Vader is this legendary villain, and you don't necessarily get why. I mean, we do because, you know, we've seen him be evil and everything, but you wish you had more of that backbone of why. And I would watch the hell out of that movie.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah. I would too.
It'd be amazing.
Yeah. So yeah, no.
I'm sorry, not necessarily just in that, how evil he is, but just the physical prowess.
Yeah.
Like, and the fighting skill. Yeah. That's what I'm wanting.
Yeah, because a lot of people like to make fun that, especially after Rogue One came out, that he was able to move so nimbly and fast, and he split dudes in half. And then when you see him fight Ben Kenobi in Episode 4, he's like, they're like two old dudes like fighting with broomsticks, you know?
If they had it all to do over again.
Yeah, I'm sure, yeah. But you can never touch 4, 5, and 6. Like, people would riot if you want to remake those. So.
But that...
As it is, people are already, like, in a bitchy fit, which I can understand. But the theatrical release... movies have never actually been released to home video. It's the ones that George Lucas edited after the fact. So a lot of the things have changed, and I guess it's a good as time as ever to transition to Episode 4, where Solo in the original shot first, but in this one it was
it doesn't matter, the bounty hunter guy.
Yeah,
not Boba Fett, whatever.
Greedo. Greedo. But in the edited ones, Greedo shot first, So that's a whole controversy thing. And now in the ones that you see on Disney Plus, like for some reason, Greedo yells McCuster like out of nowhere, just like randomly. So people are mad that they go back and retouch them when they don't need to be retouched. Yeah, but so obviously in episode 4 we get the transition now. Where episode 3 ends is they give the twins away. Alderaan, and she's a prince there. That's Princess Leia. And then Luke is given to his Uncle Ben in Tatooine. And they're separated and they have no idea what's going on. But episode 4 is then the original Star Wars movie that was released in 1977. So did you is that one of the ones you watched this week?
No, but I've seen it.
You've seen it before? Yeah. Does it's obviously, you know, it's hard to compare even now with the movies, the Star Wars movies that they do, but do you think it holds up?
Yes. I mean, it's not, it's, yes, I do, but I'd still rather watch the newer ones. But it's a good story. I like it. It's fun. But as far, yeah, if we're going off, like, lightsaber duels and, like, special effects, stuff like that. Yeah, you got to go with the later ones. But as far as like character design and fleshing out the characters and stuff, yeah, it's a good movie. It really is. I get why that's built this entire empire.
Dude, for sure. Like that is the basis of everything else that's spun out of that. So I could, and that was one of my questions actually, is if like you understand why so many people have the, you know, almost devoted their life.
It's to nothing. Star that Wars. Movie is complete potential.
Oh, for sure. In 1977, you see that movie and you're like, what the fuck? Mm-hmm. Like, that would blow my mind, you know? And for sure. I love the idea that, you know, this one single person has this power, this, you know, the Force with them, and the Force is what helps him blow up the Death Star. I really enjoyed episode 4, and obviously Han Solo plays a huge part in that. I love...
You love a good Han Solo.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. That character archetype has been taken from that movie and put in every other movie since then. Like, this swashbuckling, you know, like, for sure. George Lucas was able to create, no matter what you think of his later work, prequels, you know, not withholding or withstanding, he created something that, you know, people have paid homage, just straight up stolen and stuff like that. it definitely, the idea of Star Wars definitely stands the test of time and forever. And R2-D2, C-3PO, just, and the idea that he created this vast universe that you can play. I mean, we're still seeing it today. We're seeing The Mandalorian.
We're
going to
see it in a week.
We're going to see it in a week. Like, it's just crazy, you know, and for sure. Like, I think it's definitely worth, you know, the reason that it's still 50 years later, you know, almost 50 years. Like, it's still... stands a test of time, I think.
So. And I thoroughly do enjoy that they keep filling the universe up.
Yeah, I think, like, yeah.
There's always, every movie you see, there's new planets being introduced or new, maybe species or whatever. I enjoy that. It seems like, I mean, they're, it's a cash cow, don't get it wrong. Oh, yeah, they're wringing the fuck out of it, but, or milking the fuck out of it, but it is, creatively, it is good to see. That all completely fleshed out too. So
I agree, absolutely. Okay, so there's really not much, you know, we can say about episode 1. Obviously, Obi-Wan Kenobi ends his story there from the trilogy and into the first one, and he dies. You know, kind of
Does anyone ever really die?
Well, no, they're
they become Jedi, spirit projections.
Jedi ghosts, yeah. You know, if you strike me down, I will come back more, even more powerful than you can ever imagine. So that's pretty cool. So obviously, what a lot of people think is the best Star Wars movie ever is Episode 5, Empire Strikes Back. I know when you text me about it, you had, you know...
Let's just... Maybe in 1979, whatever.
1982.
But, I'm blown away. But this one...
Do you not like it, or just compared to...
It's not that I don't like it. It's fine.
I really enjoy Empire Strikes Back. Yeah. Just because I watched it when I didn't know that turn. And it's difficult if you see this later and you know of Star Wars and you know the mythology and you know that Darth Vader is Luke's father. But when you watch it and you don't know, like, that shit will take you for a ride, you know? So I watched it as a kid and I didn't know. So that was pretty cool. Yeah.
If that would have happened to me, I probably would have held it more in reverence than I do. But.
And that's the thing, I think, with Star Wars is if you watch it later in life, like, it's not as revered, I think, as you're just like, oh, like, people have done it better since then. But when you, like, when this is one of your original, like, franchises that you watch, you know, you tend to hold it in a little bit more Prestige. Who was it? Bill Burr, comedian. Was it Bill Burr? I think it might have been Bill Burr. He said he didn't watch the Star Wars movies as a kid. So when he watched it later, he was just like,
okay,
I don't get it. Yeah. Which is funny because he was in the last episode of The Mandalorian.
Nice.
Yeah. So, but I can get it. But no, you know, we get a lot of stuff that we, you know, from episode 5, we get Boba Fett, who to me is the most overrated Star Wars character of all time. We talked about it last week. He's just kind of like, you know, a fucking Benny Hill character.
You know who else I think is overrated?
Who's that?
Jabba the Hutt.
Yeah.
That might be blasphemous.
No, I think it's more blasphemous for you to say for me saying Boba Fett is overrated. Well,
Jabba the Hutt's overrated. Get out of here with Jabba the Hutt. He doesn't do anything like that.
We're just supposed to take at face value that he is this great criminal.
Why? He didn't. You know he wasn't out doing things. I can tell you that much for right now. He wasn't out, like in The Godfather 2. You see how Don Vito, like, he was out murdering people or whatever he was doing because he had to go do it. Jabba the Hutt was never out going door to door making deals. No, he wasn't. He was sitting in his big ass. Just how? I want to know how that character becomes what he is, because I don't think...
I'm sure there's some legend, you know, or some book that somebody wrote one time that, you know, kind of explains that. But yeah, we're just talking about that.
As it stands, overrated to me.
A little bit.
And he died really easily. this supposed giant empire that he built was gone like 2 minutes.
Well, yeah, like 2 seconds, yeah. And that's the start of the third movie. Well, obviously the second movie ends in a big cliffhanger, you know, Luke. Well, he actually didn't say, Luke, I am your father. He just says, I am your father.
No, I am your father. Yeah. No, I am your father.
Yeah. Which is a big Mandela effect kind of thing, where people think he says, Luke, I am your father. But he doesn't.
Well, just, I think the people just need the context for it, so they add Luke.
Yeah. Han Solo gets frozen in carbonite. Leia is... where is Leia?
She was taken hostage by Jabba and them.
And obviously, how can we talk about Empire Strikes Back? My favorite scene in that movie probably is the beginning when they're on Hoth and they're fighting. That for 1982, and still even today, you can argue that is very good.
It was really good.
You know, computer animation and a lot of stop motion and stuff like that. So
there's what's with, well, I don't want to take too much time on it, but what do you know about this controversy that Mark Hamill got in a car crash and they said that's why they added that whole scene with the.
I think that's true because then he needed to be outstretched because of his back. Yeah, I think that's true. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
They rewrote the whole movie.
Well, he's the star of the movie, wild. Yeah. So that's pretty cool. And then how he cuts into the Tauntaun and, you know, goes inside the whole thing. I like all that. I like that scene. I like that whole.
I'll tell you this. For whatever reason, this is the movie. Empire Strikes Back. It's the movie I started like 17 times. And I fell asleep in the first 10 minutes every freaking time.
It starts the best. I could see A New Hope because it takes a little bit to get up there.
The New Hope. That happened to me, The New Hope, too.
Yeah, but no. This one starts off with the battle on Ice Planet. Like, that's fucking dope.
Yeah, I don't know.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
What are you going to do?
Yeah. So it leaves on a cliffhanger. Episode 3 starts with Luke going after Leia and after...
Episode 6, excuse me.
How he goes after... Leia in Jabba's hut and defreezes
Jabba's hut. Is it Jabba's hut?
Poor question. And you get Han Solo back, and then we forgot to mention Lando Calrissian in Episode 2, how he betrayed him. So that's son of a bitch.
Which actually
makes sense though, because
wasn't even that bad. It wasn't good, but he didn't have any choice really.
Well, and then not only that, the last time we saw in the mythos, we see Han Solo interact with Lando Calrissian, he betrayed him in a card game. So it's like, why should I trust this motherfucker?
Yeah, for real.
So I totally get it. But he did turn face. Yeah, at the end of the movie.
I remember watching it, and like, I've heard the legend of Lando Calrissian. Oh, he betrayed him, and then that happened. And I'm like, that sucks. But I thought it was way worse than that. I thought it was like he didn't have a choice. He just wanted money and like. But no, he didn't. Weren't they like forcing his hand?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, when Darth Vader comes a knocking, it's like,
what are you supposed to do?
Figure entity in the galaxy. You're not gonna fuck with that guy.
Yeah, but he didn't just betray him just to betray him. Yeah. Like someone in The Last Jedi we could talk about.
Yeah.
Is it Last? Yeah, Last Jedi. It wasn't like that. His hand was forced, so people made too big a deal of that. I am glad he did a face turn at the end too. So.
What do you think? The big beef with people in this movie is the Ewoks. Do you find an issue that the Ewoks was able they were able to take down the Empire?
No, I liked it. It's kind of cool. It the one thing I will call bullshit on. They have like one day and they set like even like less a few hours set up all these giant traps with trees and whatever and they like just cut a string and like 1,000 trees fall down and there's these giant rock piles I think and all these sorts of traps they didn't have like an hour to prepare with them. But other than that
I really enjoy about the trilogy the original trilogy even more than the prequel trilogy is that because a lot of the prequel trilogy you get in senate rooms and stuff like that which we said it was fine we enjoyed it but you don't get a lot of scenery in the original trilogy you like they're fighting on an ice planet and then in episode 3 there's an entire jungle planet or forest planet I like that I really like that scenery and stuff like that
I will say they as far as like sets I don't know if it's set scenes or whatever it is they all look pretty good especially when you consider how old they are they all look really good actually
I really like the way that it comes together. And obviously, episode six ends with them taking down the Empire. Luke is being killed by the Emperor, and then Darth Vader, Anakin has a change of heart. He throws the Emperor down the Donald, whatever you want to call it, a shaft. And Darth Vader dies because he's old. And then you take his face, you take his thing off, and you're expecting black dude because Earl James Earl Jones does the voice, but it's like this whimpery little old white dude. And then the end of episode 6 ends with, especially the remastered ones, ends with Obi-Wan Kenobi, Anakin Skywalker, and Yoda as the spirit ghost. And we forgot to mention Yoda in episode 2. Empire Strikes Back. So
episode 5. That was excellent. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, Yoda fighting was wild as hell.
Yeah, I loved it.
I remember when I watched that the first time. That's like the only thing I remember from that movie for watching it the first time.
When Yoda's flipping around and shit.
Yeah. With Yoda fighting. That's pretty much the only thing I remember from watching it. And that's why I had to watch it again because I couldn't remember anything except Yoda fought awesomely. That's it. That's why I'm super glad I freaking watched it again.
Do you prefer puppet Yoda or CGI?
Actually, you know what's crazy? I had never seen Empire Strikes Back. I didn't know Yoda died.
Yeah, I had no idea.
Yeah. I thought he was still happy and living. That's crazy. I just found that out like what, 2 weeks ago, whatever.
But which one do you prefer, puppet or CGI? Because you know who does...
I'll probably say CGI.
You know who does Yoda, right? Frank Oz, who does all the Muppets. And he does the voice, too. He does the voice of Miss Piggy, Kermit. I don't know if he does the voice for Kermit, Yoda is Sesame Street and Muppet Creation, like, it's Frank Oz.
Wow.
Yeah.
I think I prefer CGI.
I like Puppet. Just because I like... And that's the thing I also like better about the prequel... Or, excuse me, the original trilogy than the prequel trilogy is the practical effects. I think Star Wars needs to be practical effects with the monsters and shit like that. Like, not that the monsters...
As much as you can.
Maybe. Yeah, not that the monsters look bad in episode 1-3, because General Grievous looks good, all those monsters look good, but there's something about practical effects... And they just makes them look more believable, you know? And I really enjoy that, so I prefer Puppet Yoda, so...
No, I mean...
You know, actually...
I don't have a strong preference either way, but...
You know actually who Frank Oz is in Knives Out? He's the lawyer.
The lawyer. Oh, okay. That's him. The will reader?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's him.
Okay.
So, yeah, that's cool.
I'm getting up there.
So, episode 6 ends with them taking down the Empire. Everything's a happy ending. What we think is...
Yeah, ostensibly ends happily. Yes. And everyone's good.
So then we get episode... What would that be? 7. The Force Awakens. We are introduced to a bunch of new characters. Primarily Rey, who is... we don't know how, but she's Force sensitive. And we have Kylo Ren, who is the grandson of Darth Vader. Nephew to Luke Skywalker. And son of Han Solo and Leia, who ended up getting together. So, what ultimately do you think of episode 7?
Okay, so we're introduced to the idea of the First Order, which really takes the place of the Empire essentially. The first thing that stuck out to me, what I don't like, And I can't exactly put my finger on necessarily why I don't like it, but it's just annoying. They seem to be able to pull out these Darth... What is he? The Supreme Leader?
Supreme Leader Snoke.
Supreme... Okay. Where did he come from? He's just out... He's just there now.
Well, that's the thing...
That annoys me.
That's... We can talk to them about as one, because we're already running an hour and we got to get you out of here. But we can talk to them about one movie, Episode 7 and 8. The reason that Last Jedi is so controversial is because anytime it wanted to answer a question from Episode 7, it's just like, fuck it. So remember the scene where Kylo Ren is like, who cares who the fuck your parents were? Like, you have to write your own story. Like, J.J. Abrams, the director and writer of Episode 7, was going to lead this thing. And then Rian Johnson, who directed Knives Out, was like, who gives a shit? So the same thing with Emperor Snoke. He's supposed to be this great figure. Ooh, maybe he's the Emperor coming back. Who gives a shit? Cuts him in half. So a lot of people didn't like Episode 8 because it, like, was meta almost. And, like... And didn't follow the same tropes that all the same Star Wars movies did, which...
Like, fuck your ideas.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, which is a criticism of actually Episode 7, where they're sending the exact same movie as Episode 4. There's a big ball, and they're destroying it, and, you know, it's destroying planets, so you have to go shoot it down.
I got a little bit of that, but it's different enough.
So Episode 8, The Last Jedi, is very subversive as far as, like, I'm not going to follow any of your tropes. All of Episode 7 was like, oh my god, I have Luke Skywalker. I have Luke Skywalker's lightsaber, like, oh my god. And what does he do the very beginning of Episode 8? He just tosses it.
Yeah.
So that's what I really thoroughly enjoy Episode 8, because it's like...
Fuck all this noise.
Fuck your Star Wars mythology.
And at the end, let it all die. Who gives a shit?
Exactly. Like, I love that about it. So people... That's kind of cool. That's what I'm saying. A lot of Star Wars fandom is really toxic. And that movie gets it the most. Because it's like, that's not my Star Wars. Which I thoroughly enjoy The Last Jedi. Because not only is it a good movie, but like a lot of these, like, that's not my Star Wars. Living in mom's basement is like, fuck you, asshole. And you're still crying about that movie.
Well, the changing directors doesn't necessarily change the writing, does it? I mean,
it
wouldn't change the screenplay, I wouldn't assume. Who wrote it?
It changed it enough that I think Rian Johnson did.
Okay. Yeah. In that case.
It changed it enough to where this past week, actually, J.J. Abrams had to release a comment about previous comments that he made, kind of criticizing The Last Jedi because it didn't follow exactly the threads that he left open for. Basically, like, no Star Wars fans want a meta... movie about Star Wars, and like how a lot of the threads that he left there for Episode 7 he has to answer now in Episode 9.
He's doing Episode 9 again?
Yeah.
Wow. I kind of like that though. That's cool. That's the best of both worlds, really.
That's what I'm saying.
You get this kind of anarchist thing in the middle.
And that's what I really liked. Because, and not only that, but it answers more, it puts up more questions as far as like, well, you know, Kylo Ren and Rey are fighting back to back, but then at the end there's another, like, twist. I totally dig that.
Me too.
And then, you know, ultimately what I really liked about that is, like, you know, I've said
you're getting rid of all the conventions.
And exactly. And ultimately my favorite part of that movie was, you know, Star Wars is always like, oh, somebody's parent. And you're going into Episode 7 or into Episode 8, it's like, oh, is Rey a Kenobi? Like, did Ben Kenobi have a wife while he was a Tatooine, you know, all this stuff. And then Kylo Ren ultimately is like, who gives a shit? Your parents were trash and they threw you in a trash planet. Who gives a shit? And when I saw that, I'm like, that is badass, because everybody's expecting, like, oh my god, you're a Skywalker. And then Kylo Ren is like, no, you're a trash person from a trash planet, but you can rewrite your history now. And I'm like, dude, that is so awesome, because it...
You mean nothing to anyone but me?
Exactly. That subverts the idea that everybody's connected in this giant universe, and I totally, totally dig that, which is why The Last Jedi is one of my favorite Star Wars movies.
It's a good movie. I really enjoyed it. But you really do, with the closing of this trilogy, I believe you will end up getting the best of both worlds.
I think so, too.
This is the Star Wars, right? Episode 7. Here's Star Wars. This is Star Wars. Then 8, you have a bunch of wrenches for me to throw in your spokes.
Yeah.
But then, at the end, you get the guy who wrote the 7th one to sort them all out. That's cool. That's the best of both worlds. That's the best you could possibly ask for.
He's
going to have all these new things to play with. Like, and you're wasting your time bitching about it. Like, you're welcome. And you get to write a cooler movie now.
And this is what it is. People were mad that Episode 7 was so much like Episode 4. And they're like, it's the same movie. And then they bitch that Episode 7 is so completely different. It's like, it's not my Star Wars. No, it's the poll question from last week. Is anybody ever happy ever? No. Poll question again. Because I want to ask it again. So,
I'm on board with that.
Yeah, for sure. And there is one little thing I didn't like about that movie.
Let him sort out all the wrenches.
I think so, too.
And he'll do it in the way that it was meant to be done. Yeah. That's awesome.
Ultimately, Rey.
Why would you not like
Ultimately, that? Rey's going to have famous parents or parents, whatever. The lightsaber's going to be more than whatever. But for a movie, none of that fucking mattered. And I totally dug that. You know what I mean?
So, I'm with you. Yeah. I'm with you on that.
One thing I didn't like about The Last Jedi, though, was the casino planet scene. It seemed force to me. I didn't like that very much, but whatever.
What else are you gonna do?
Yeah.
The one thing I didn't like is, it was conveniently a great smuggler.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Just right here in the jail. So it, a lot of people, I wouldn't say it's necessarily a criticism, I guess, but even, like, a lot of people, like, if you read Charles Dickens' books, they're all built on these amazing coincidences that would never totally happen. Star Wars, kind of the same thing.
Yeah, I mean,
kind of the same thing. Yeah. I'm not bitching, but I'm just saying there's an awful lot of coincidences. That's all I'm saying.
Alrighty, then we kind
of. Oh, another no. One okay. thing. One thing does bother the fuck out of me.
Okay.
Really, it. Actually, too. And this kind of goes along with. There's two complaints here. One of them falls right in line with the idea that what's his name, Snoke. He just comes out of nowhere, just falls right out of the sky, and suddenly he's this great character. Same thing with the new Admiral Lady, which I thought could have had something new.
I do have an issue with that, that Gwendolyn Stacy, who is Lady Brienne of Tarth from Game of Thrones, they build her up, particularly in the Episode 7 trailers, that she's a big badass or whatever, and she's used just like Boba Fett, like, just like, she's thrown in the trash bin in the first one, and then the second one, she, like, falls or whatever, and I'm like, if you're gonna build up a character like that...
Wait, are we talking about the same person?
Yeah, the
purple-haired lady on the...
Oh, no, I'm talking...
Who are you talking about?
I'm talking about, she's the main commander, Stormtrooper, what the fuck is her name?
Oh! No, I like what they did with her.
I know.
It's Chrome Dome.
Yeah.
I know what you're talking
about. No, I totally think she could have had a better role in that. It's particularly because it's... Particularly now that I've watched Game of Thrones,
She's a great actress.
Gwendolyn Stacy's amazing. Yeah. And, yeah, like, for them to, like, just, like, whatever.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
But I understand what you're saying, and where they just kind of, like, crashed.
Well, what I wondered is...
That should have been Leia, honestly. Now that we know that... That she passed away.
That's what I'm wondering. Yeah. If it had anything to do with Carrie Fisher's death.
Maybe. I think if Carrie Fisher maybe died while they were still editing, like, they find a way for her to be the one to crash. But from what I heard in Episode 9, like, there are scenes that that she's in. So I think she's going to get some closure as a character. So.
Well, but, okay, I still have problems with this other character then. I don't even know her name. It doesn't matter. But she just dropped right in our laps. And she's supposed to be this big badass, and... Okay, that's not even my real issue. My real issue is, if she's so smart, why did she wait until the very end? She knew she was going to die. Why didn't you run into them from the fucking beginning and save 15-year escape pods? You just killed half your separatist army, your rebels.
That is one of the criticisms of that movie.
What are you doing? You did it anyway.
If you were going to do it
from the beginning.
Just do it at the very beginning, yeah.
And save... Half your fucking people. What are you doing?
And
some great leader.
That cuts the movie by like 30 minutes, too. That's why. So, yeah. I get it.
What are you doing?
Whatever. Okay. So.
And now, the entire Rebel army can fit on one Millennium Falcon.
Yeah.
Which isn't even like that big.
No, it's not.
So.
So, real quick, because we got to get CJ out of here. What are some predictions here for Episode 9? I think we find out who Rey's parents are.
Probably.
Because that's a huge deal.
Is Luke dead?
Yes, he's supposed to be dead. He's not.
Spoilers for all this. Sorry.
Yeah.
If we spoil, yeah. Fuck you.
It's Star Wars.
Yeah. Go fuck yourself if you haven't seen the movie. You son of a bitch.
Yeah, it's he's supposed to be dead, but he's like a spirit ghost. But I think Rise of Skywalker is to mean something bigger, like something's going
Rey.
To happen.
I think Rey is Skywalker.
You think she's a Skywalker?
I think.
Yeah.
I think. That's
I think there's gonna be out. About like a maybe like a 5 to 10 year difference between or. Span between the last movie and this movie where they have gotten more more people to the resistance.
Probably.
Yeah, which is why, like, at the end of the second movie, when they're playing with the little figures and stuff, like, you see, like, they are. I think there's people gonna Rey's gonna be mythologized, I think, a little bit, and people are gonna try to want to be like her, which is like a Jedi and part of the resistance and stuff.
I can't tell you what exactly will happen. I can tell you what I want to happen. I want there to be a new Jedi Order by the end of it.
Which I think they might be called the Skywalkers. That's where I'm going from. They're not going to be...
You think Jedis will be called Skywalkers?
I think it'll be like a branch off of Jedi. He wanted the Jedis to die. Like, he said that the Jedis were just as bad for the shit they created after all this, you know, all the research and study that he did. So I think ultimately the Jedi die with Luke, and something else comes out.
But I want whatever that something else.
And is. I think that's where the title is hinting at Rise of Skywalker. I think so. I think yeah, and I think Kylo.
But the idea of that order is cool. So
yeah, I think so too.
Whatever, regardless of whatever you call it, it's cool. So I want it.
I think Kylo Ren dies. I think he does a full face turn, but he dies saving Ren for somehow at the end. We get hints that the Emperor is going to be in this movie, that he's back. So I like to see how that plays out.
The Emperor? What Emperor? Palpatine?
Yeah.
No, wow, he's dead. Well, I guess I don't know.
Yeah. Watch the trailer.
He was like 190 years old. Whatever.
But yeah, we'll see where this goes. So I guess ultimately, now that we got to get you out of here, CJ, what are your... From somebody that just finished it yesterday, what are your overall thoughts on the Star Wars saga?
I like it, and I'm happy it exists.
Good, good.
Yeah, mostly.
Why? What's?
It's overhyped, but it's good. It's good.
But can you see why people
yes.
love it so much?
Yes, yeah. I do.
It's some people's predators, believe it or not.
And I might actually. There's a good chance I'm going to delve even deeper into
yeah,
it. So.
Yeah. Yeah, and just a real quick shout out, like, the right now we have The Mandalorian and stuff, and you should get into that. Like, watch it.
I'm not going to be a Star Wars nerd, though. I'm telling you right now, I'm not.
That's fine, but at least when somebody does a reference, you'll get it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I do like it.
Yeah.
And it's very good.
I highly suggest you watch The Mandalorian.
But I'm not going to be like, I'm not going to know this droid's name or the... There's nerds out there.
Oh, for sure.
Who
for
are
sure.
just bananas.
Yeah.
I'm
yeah.
not doing that. Yeah. But... I'm thoroughly enjoying it. I'm glad you made me watch.
Good,
to be
good.
Honest.
I'm glad I did. So, with that, we're not going to rank them because that's going to take too long.
I don't even know if I could.
Okay, what would you say is your favorite Star Wars movie? If you have to do three of them. I can do them right now. Rogue One, Empire Strikes Back, Last Jedi. Those are my three favorite.
Wait, say it again?
Rogue One.
Oh, okay. Rogue One's on my list.
Empire Strikes Back and Last Jedi.
Let me do this in, like, no order. No particular order. Rogue One's in there, Last Jedi's in there, Attack of the Clones is in there for me, probably. Now I think I'd put Revenge of the Sith in there, probably. So, I'll do four.
Revenge of the Sith is pushing in there for sure. I like Revenge of the Sith. So, we miss a bunch because, like I said, we gotta get CJ to work. But let us know, question of the show is, what is your favorite Star Wars movie? And then in general, what is your... what is some of your favorite Star Wars moment? I think we've named a couple of them. The Duel of the Fates lightsaber fight, the fight at the end of Revenge of the Sith, just the Last Jedi in general. I think just like Rian Johnson saying fuck you to everybody, that was probably my favorite Star Wars moment. There's a lot of stuff you can pick from these.
Yeah, if you're interested, just expound on your love for Star Wars for a while.
Let us.
I'm more than happy to read big long posts about why you love Star Wars and what cool things about Star Wars.
And honestly, we could do this show for like 2 hours just talking about Star Wars. But I think we're going to cut it off there. And
let this be your Star Wars outlet.
Yeah. And I'll go ahead and cut it off here. We can get... I'll finish it off
keep going. I have recommendations.
Okay. All right. We're getting the fuck out of here. Next week, obviously, we're gonna review Star Wars 9 or Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker. CJ will be here. Barker, maybe. I don't know. Andres wants to be, so we'll go there. Okay, what are you reading, watching that you want to recommend?
I probably did pick a bad week to do this. But I'm a music nerd, as everyone knows. This probably won't be my most popular segment. But I'm a metal nerd, among other things. I have a list of 5 albums that I want everyone to... No, it exists. I don't know. You can be metal nerd, right? That's a thing.
Yeah, no.
Anyway, there's
a band. Or anything that we consider nerd. That's in the fucking title.
I'm saying. There's a band called Angel Maker, which is a great name. I love that. I don't know. I love it. They have a self-titled album. It's fucking amazing. These are all albums that came out in 2019. Sorry. I do a huge list every year of all my favorite albums. These are only five of them. There's a band called Serpent of Gnosis, which has Johnny Davey from Job for a Cowboy. And he's a fucking machine. I love that dude. He's one of my favorite vocalists ever. And they have a album called As I Drink from the Infinite Well of Inebriation, which is just great.
That's a great title.
Cattle Decapitation is back. They're the most they're crazy. Their entire thing is that everyone's gonna die. It's like soon. Like, they're these crazy vegan dudes who hate anybody using plastic bottles or like they're awesome. They made an album called Death Atlas and it's phenomenal. Blood Incantation made an album called Hidden History of the Human Race. Death metal riffs everywhere. It's fucking awesome. Check it out. But last and finally, super not least, Norma Jean.
Norma Jean is
so
back.
Good.
Norma Jean is back.
They have an album out called All Hail, and it's phenomenal. I was in love with their last album, Polar Similar, but I think they outshined themselves this time even. And I love that album, and I love this one even more, I think. So, yeah, go check all those out. All
right, and I guess...
And if you follow me on Twitter and you want to know more about any of that, just DM me or whatever, and I'll tell you all about it.
Yeah, for sure. And then I guess while I got TJ here, my recommendation is Crisis on Infinite Earths, the CW crossover event right now. Obviously, it's super CW, super cheese, but it's really good, actually. It's a five-episode crossover event. There are three episodes in. Two of them are going to be in January. But yeah, the first three episodes are really good. And dude, I don't think you understand the magnitude that the CW did. They brought back characters from the old Batman, Tim Burton Batman universe. And they basically, all the universes they touched upon, like the DC streaming universe, there's a world in this universe. Like, it's crazy. Like, they touch upon every DC character or movie ever. And
I'm not gonna pretend like that's not cool,
dude. It's pretty fucking cool. It's pretty amazing. And basically, what it is, it's the Anti-Monitor, this big universal galactic bad guy. He sent out a wave of antimatter, and it's destroying planets one by one. And when you see planets destroyed one by one, you see the Smallville universe. Remember that old TV show? You see the Batman 89 universe. You see the Batman 66 universe, dude. It's cool. It's cool. They even bring back Brandon Routh's Batman from Superman Returns from the early the early 2000s, that Superman movie that nobody watched. But yeah, it's really cool. I really highly recommend it. It's on the CW app for free if you want to watch it. So check it out. And I'll go ahead and close the show here in a little bit. So TJ, we can go ahead and take you to go home.
Okay, bye.
Okay, bye. Alrighty, and we're back. Alright, CJ left for work. I went on a quick workout, and now I'm here to close out the show. Last 5 minutes or so, less than that. But if you guys have any suggestions or comments, let us know on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram. You can find the podcast's official page on Facebook and Twitter. You can find me officially at Saint_Able45. You can find CJ at CJMFA. You can find Dustin at Dustin Barker. I don't know. I don't ever pay attention. You can find the podcast specifically on Spotify, Google Play, Apple Podcasts, Libsyn, Stitcher, or anywhere that you get your podcast. Buy some merch. It's a good Christmas present for you guys. And I'm still working on putting the new logo up. It's giving me a hard time, but I'll figure it out. Patreon, please donate. It would really, really be beneficial for us if you guys can please donate on Patreon. We really appreciate that. If you want to do a one-time donation, it's like, hey guys, I really appreciate your breakdown of the Star Wars universe. Do a one-time donation at nerdworldorder2@gmail.com. We would really appreciate that. And like I said, next week we're going to break down the newest Star Wars edition and see how the episode or the saga concludes. So join us next week. And as always, obey the NWO. Oh, you're